We now move to our penultimate panel discussion before we break for our award ceremony. We discuss the challenges faced in media literacy. The chair for this session, please welcome Mr. Brij Bawa, Senior Editorial Lead, BW Business World. Joining him on stage to discuss the motion, Dr. Ruchi Jaggi, Director, Symbiosis Institute of Media and Communication, Professor Charulata, VSJMC Vivekanand Institute of Professional Studies, Ms. Shikha Rai, Assistant Professor IGNU, Dr. Neeru Johri, HOD BJMC, Managing Editor, Mass Communicator in Charge, Community Radio, GYMS. Mr. Suresh Gaur, Professor, SP College of Communication and Management, Bharti Vidya Bhavan. Professor Farhad Basir Khan, AJK Mass Communication Research Center, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi.
I will be very brief.
Professor Usha Rani, Department of Communication and Journalism in the University of Mysore. Ladies and gentlemen, can we have a huge round of applause for our panelists as well as our panel chair?
Hello everybody, am I audible? Can you please, iski thodi awaaz bada de?
Brij, I'll hand over to you.
Thank you. Thanks. So the best thing about this panel is that, you know, this is the only panel which has majority of ladies. So a big round of applause for this panel for, you know, achieving that. And the power of women. Yes. So, you know, I've been sitting here since, you know, afternoon, and I've noticed that there are parts of this discussion which were really interesting. There were parts which were not. And I'll be very frank about it. I want to make this panel as interesting as possible. And this topic is, I guess, the most interesting. You know, it's media literacy. It doesn't just concern students. It concerns common people as well, especially with the times we are living in. May I put it into perspective that a single message today can actually kill a person, right? And a single message can start a revolution. I was just discussing with our executive editor, and you know, he stated that a single message started the Arab Spring, right? Right from Egypt to Syria to Libya. And we saw how the whole scenario of the Middle East as we see today changed. We also see how social media websites are banned in countries like Pakistan and China, and how they have stopped revolutions in the past, haven't allowed revolutions to come up. How many of you know about a gentleman called Antonio Gramsci? Anybody? Antonio Gramsci, right? He was a post-Marxist scholar who said that the revolutions could never happen because of something he called hegemony or power, which we don't see as power, but it is being exercised upon us. Antonio Gramsci would have been very happy today. Why? Because the power is in the hands of the people now, right? It's not anymore in the hands of the government. It's not anymore in the hands of the institutions. It's in the hands of the people. With a single text message, we can start riots and we can start revolutions. So my first question to my panelists today is, and we'll keep it very crisp, we'll keep it very short, and we'll keep it a question-answer session rather than keynote addresses, because that's how we can make it really interesting for our audience as well. Why do you guys think media literacy today is important, not just for your students, but also for common people sitting here watching us? I hope this will come on TV as well shortly. And, you know, why is it important? Maybe start from this side. Maybe we can go.
Yeah. Thank you, Brij. Good evening to everyone. And I think Brij has made it very interesting. He has opened the discussion with question answers. And you know, when we came here, and most of us were discussing, now where is the energy left? Is anybody going to be interested in listening? And when we saw the food there, and everything was so, and we were all talking about it, you know. But definitely, you know, media literacy, like you have shared, one word, one sentence, one piece of information can create revolution. and accessing that information is very, very important. And everybody has been talking about content and the attention span, the diversification, the rift which is going on between private and government universities. There is a representation of both, and the gaps between real life situations and so many things. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to media literacy, I think it's very, very interesting what you've shared. And I would like to talk, there was a panelist from, I think, Madras, and Shridhar was there. I would like to talk in context of community media, which is community radio. I want to share experiences of that. We run a community radio stations, and we are talking about maths literacy. We are doing a half an hour program on maths literacy. And when we did research, there were challenges at three levels. The content, and we all talk about content only, the operationalization is also very, very important. Very important, very difficult, and the financial aspect. How you sustain yourself in community media and in some specifically in context of community radio. And when we did lot of things what we were doing, and generating content is very, very difficult. What people want, it somebody shared, like, it is the organization's prerogative. But when you talk of media literacy, I think when we talk of reaching out to the unreached, it is the other way around, what they want. And the whole focus through radio stations is generating content, and especially in context of maths. Generally, it is already it is audiovisual, which has been the prerogative, which is evidence also shows, and we are doing it through oral medium. So there are challenges in media literacy of content, how you generate content, and what the people want. And making the people speak is very difficult. It is very easy to say, like, it is very when you're talking of in context of community radio, but getting them to radio stations to talk about their problems is very, very challenging. And I think that's one of the challenges.
Okay, so I would like to put another question in front of you guys, and it's a very important question. You are professors, you make the futures of our country, and the kids who come to your classes come from various backgrounds, And a certain background might make a person right wing, a certain background might make a person left wing. My parents have been very open since start. That makes me a more liberal person, right? In a classroom with a bunch of students, it's very important to maneuver their thinking. Maneuver might be a negative word, maybe in a very positive way, to change their thinking as to something which is more liberal, And that's also part of media literacy. Why? Because ultimately those students will go to journalism institutions and actually tell people what to think and what not to. See what we are listening today. Apart from 1-2 channels, everybody is there barking on this, news channels and giving us certain opinions. Media today makes opinions. So how difficult it is for you, and anybody can take this answer, how difficult it is for you to actually inculcate ideas in students which can make them, put in perspective certain opinions once they become professionals and to change people's mindset in a positive way. Yes, you took the mic up. You can go ahead.
All right. So I think the question that you raise is extremely significant because we are not just dealing with students who come from diverse backgrounds, but I think currently in the current context, we are also dealing with very charged opinions, yes. Right? And that's a huge struggle because you as a teacher can also seem to be imposing an opinion, right? Where there could be a reaction which can be very aggressive without understanding the nuances of the
absolutely,
argument.
Absolutely.
I always think that it is very important for a teacher, we all have our political ideologies. I don't think that any one of us is apolitical. And I think professors of media studies, if they are apolitical, they don't have to be teaching media
There's
studies.
Nobody apolitical.
Right.
Everybody has
that. If they claim to be. Yes. So what I'm trying to say is that very important. So if I lean towards the right or the left, it's very important for me to use texts, use examples, use evidences, which put before them both points of view.
Yes,
right? I mean, just like a journalist who we expect to be fair in reporting, balanced in reporting. As a teacher, you have to be so aware and conscious of doing that. That's one thing that brings in a more nuanced discussion in classrooms.
That's a very important point. Putting both the perspectives in and let the student decide which perspective they want to.
Right. And just last thing to this, I also think that it is also important to tell the student that what we think and what they think, there is no right and wrong in it.
Absolutely.
I think unless we engage more with subjectivity, I mean, people have been talking about journalism and objectivity so much today, but I think everybody just dumbs down the idea of media education to teaching people skills, being objective, forgetting that everybody bases their experiences in a certain context. And you cannot be completely objective about it. So I think if we get more fluidity in the classrooms, we'll be able to definitely channelize some sort of critical media literacy.
Yes, ma'am, you wanted
now
to comment.
That is a typical classroom situation, which Ruchi just talked about. Am I audible? Audible now?
Yeah.
All right. That is a typical classroom situation. I come from a distance education university. And these are the times of bite-sized videos where in a few seconds you must be able to convey your message. These are also the times where teacher is not that person who is the Dronacharya of everything. You are a guide by the side. So you keep telling the people, and it's more of a hands-on experience. It's more of online learning. It's more of MOOCs, massive online open courses. So these are the times when anybody maybe on the job and has a break can attend to a lecture asynchronously or synchronously and then understand what it all means. And for all so much of information overflow that is happening, the entire onus of choosing whether the information is correct or incorrect, whether you should believe it and how much, to what extent you should believe it. Like somebody in the other panel was saying that one wrong message led to 15 deaths. That onus is on you, hence the need for media literacy. This is also one area where media industry has not really been treading.
Yeah, so most courses on media literacy, yes ma'am, I'm coming to you. Most courses, and then I'll come to you, ma'am.
I'll take it forward.
Yeah.
I'll just take it forward.
And just one interjection. Yeah. Most courses on media literacy are today offered by NGOs, journalism, companies. Institutions don't seem to be that grappling up with the problem. Don't you think, it's the onus is on more on institution side because they create the future of India?
Yeah, definitely. I would say the more onus is on the media education institutions to bring media literacy into the syllabi and to discuss these things. Because I will go back to where you started, we are living in a hyper-abundant media environments and media-mediated society we are living in. Where we have lot of media, we are 24/7, we are bombarded with, different kinds of messages from different kinds of mediums. So it is very important that each and every individual, because what is happening is, in earlier times, the media organizations or the advocacy groups or the NGOs, they had that responsibility of creating the content or spreading of the messages. What is now happening is that each and every individual in the society today is, a media factory. They are producing powerhouse or a media factory. They are creating content and just putting and sharing it. So three things I would stress on. One is the creation of the content. We should know what is being created, who is creating it, and why it is being created. What is the objective of it? And three C's. First is creation of the content. Second is communication. How it is being communicated. And the person who is receiving those messages, they need to know why they have been chosen to receive that message, why they are receiving those messages. So communication. And the third is the consumption. How you consume that content which comes to you, whether you whether you send it forward just without thinking, or what do you do with that, or you get influenced, and because each message has a power, So when it has a power, as you said, it can bring revolutions, it can bring change. We have seen how it happened in Syria, or we even, fight against corruption. So that it can bring people together, and it can, we see the lynchings.
Absolutely. So I'll come to you guys now. And the same question for you, and then I'll come to a very pertinent question that is, ma'am, you can go ahead. If you... You know, if you'd like, good ma'am first. She's been waiting for a time. Go ahead.
Hello. I take the perspective of the public, you know. Forget about media educators, journalism students, but what about the public? Because we spend most of our life with consuming media content. What happens to their mindset? Because you are creating images, and whether it is print, across print, electronic and online, you are creating, you are producing a hell lot of messages. How are the public taking it? You know, that is my worry. That is my deepest concern. That is where I support and endorse media literacy. And it is most of the, as a researcher, I have to admit that most of the studies on media literacy concern school children. And they're all studied abroad, you know, in US as well as in European countries. And they have, so it is mandatory in public education system in US, Australia and other countries to have media literacy component, okay? We need to bring it, because it is, but children are already overburdened. You don't want to add anything more, but this is a media saturated society. You need to bring in some kind of education, because public is consuming whatever, they are captive audience. They have no other alternative but to consume whatever Absolutely. Is being manufactured, Absolutely. Is being told to them, but they should be told how to watch a program and how to interpret, how to, so it is the skills, the critical
That's
thinking
a very important
skills,
point. That's
the
a
critical
very
thinking
point.
Skills. And I'm worried about the media stereotypes of whether it is gender or the Muslims or Dalits, the gender, the stereotypes that you create. And that is, you are making the national mind, Absolutely. You know, you shouldn't be doing that. But people doesn't know, because what is public interest? And what is business interest? And most of the business media houses are run on business.
As much
model.
As I want to keep listening to you, I have to, because you're raising some
Thank
amazing
you.
Points. And I'll come to both the gentlemen before I put a very interesting and very important point, and I would request your attention, is how do we create fearless students, right? Today we are in a scenario where we see people being, journalists being burdened down by fear. One is liberal mindset, the other is the fear of being open about what you think. You know, a recent example in United States of America, where a reporter from CNN actually stood up to the president, the most powerful man in the world, and said, "You know, boss, you were wrong." Right? Can that happen in India? No. And, you know, that's because we have been instilled with fear at a certain level, and we can't come up, you know, come out of it. As professors, as teachers, what do you think? And sir, I would come to you. What do you think? How can we instill fearlessness in your students? It's a very important point. I want you to, you know, restrict.
Very good, and really happy to answer this. I'm from Mass Communication Research Center, Jamia, and we are producing a very different breed of student, and then what I can do is I can share my experiences of how to inculcate that that the qualities and how to understand to how to say things which are relevant and positive. That is how we could produce Barkhadats or Shah Rukh Khan or Kabir Khan, or bring Pulitzer first time to India, or bring Oscar first time to India. That happened because when we interact with the students, we tell them the meaning and understanding of what you are saying, in what context it need to be said. And then the teaching learning format is quite different there. What I teach is by interacting with them, making them understand that how what you are writing would means what. And I let them, you know, ask them to bring clips. People who are sitting here and are my student would know that my first exercises would be actually to cull out clips from wherever they want it interesting, and then we in the classroom, you know, understand why it was created, what intent, what is viewpoint, what was the goal, is that, you know, filling up the goal or not. So this is, rather than putting it into curriculum and making it dead, what we do is it becomes a live project. It becomes a project where people are actually interacting and understanding media literacy. So there are two sides of media literacy. One side is to make people very, very aware and fearless also. The second point, actually, we are very, very nice how to make them fearless, is the moment you give them confidence, make them understand that they can, you know, can do whatever they want and get away with it, put them so much skill that they are not, you know, out of job, they can create their own, you know, businesses. The moment you make them financially secure, mentally sound, and should be, so the fearlessness comes with education. So if they are really educated in a true sense, they become quite fearless.
Yeah, so you say it depends on the personality, the type of curriculum, the teacher personality, I'm saying. So I would come to you, the same question. If you could throw some light on it with your experience, with your values, as to how to instill fearlessness among your students. And after that, we'll have a small question answer session, because, and then we'll do a wrap, right? So.
Bridge, thank you for this. I'm Suresh Gaur. I teach public relations and preach PR, both. I teach and preach PR. The question is, how to create a fearless student? There are two qualities, introvert and extrovert. If you are introvert, you can't be fearless, because you cannot explain yourself, you can express yourself. You are introvert by nature. If you are extrovert, it's all by birth, you know. If you say a teacher makes a person strong, I don't agree with this. It's your personal qualities which make you strong. Your knowledge, your experience, your expertise.
But that's a debatable statement.
And no, look, not debatable. You say teacher. I'm a teacher, I'm a preacher, both. Look, if you say that a teacher makes a student strong, there are 90 students in a class. You make every 90 students strong. No. Only few. He named Shah Rukh Khan, he named Kabir Khan, he named Barkhadat.
No, I have left. I can't read the whole directive.
So mind it. You cannot make 100 students of a class in the, say, first class, first division. There are third divisioners also, there are second divisioners also, there are toppers also. So, take it that way. I'm talking practically. You know, I'm not supporting, I respect the teaching profession, but if I say the teachers makes the students strong, no. There are so many students in the class, they are flipping with the mobile phones. They don't listen to the professors. Sorry to say this. Even professor doesn't ask them to close the phones. So how can you say this, that the teachers make them strong? They just look. I tell you, in
I'll come in.
Bridge, this question, when we talk about something, fearlessness, how to create a fearless person? A teacher cannot make anybody fearless. Mind it.
Okay. Well, that would be your opinion.
Look, by the fearless comes from the family, the parents, the atmosphere. He's grown up. She is grown up. That kind of personality built up by the family and the friends around you, that creates fearlessness. A teacher can educate you, but it depends on the student whether you get educated or not. The teacher teaches every student equally. He is, you know, guiding students on the blackboard, smartboard.
I get your point.
Got
absolutely
the point?
Yes,
what
yes,
I'm
sir.
Saying is,
go ahead, sir.
Fearlessness is a personal quality. It comes from within. If you want to be fearlessness, that you have to be very strong in that. Those girls who go to army, those who lead the cricket teams, they are fearless. Okay. How? Who made them? Just tell me, the Dangal family.
Well, okay, so I'll have to cut you short here.
Please,
and,
no problem.
There's a very strong point of view which came from professor, and we all respect that. There's nothing to, you know, as But, you know, I personally saw many of my friends in classrooms who would come from backgrounds, hail from very poor backgrounds, who would not know how to speak in front of a teacher. And we had a great teacher who would make them speak. Even if they have to give a presentation, they're not scoring good, he won't score them. He said, you know, prepare it again. I'll help you and I'll make you present. And then he'll mark them accordingly. So, you know, I guess other panelists also slightly disagree. I'll go to the audience now if there are any questions on this panel. Anybody wants to? Yes, sir.
No.
Want to suggest that media literacy has been talked about a lot, but not structured learning of media literacy, still formulated and practiced. If there's a very good initiative that Business World is creating a community of educationists, and that too in the context of media. If the media organization Business World and some interested universities and institutes can come together, create an applicable implementable media literacy concept for the school students from class 9 to 12 and actually take it forward, maybe as a CSR, maybe as an outreach. It could be a rather than we all only talk.
Comment. I'll just come to the answers. If anybody wants to take the question raised by the gentleman there, and because we are within the time limit, yes. It was actually a comment. Okay, so I have been told that this is a deadline. Okay. So, can I at least say concluding remarks? So again, thank you so much. Thank you so much, guys. It was an amazing session. I mean, this was the most interesting session, not because I was the moderator. Of course, you can give me a round of applause for that. But I had an amazing panel with amazing points of view. And I hope that, you know, media literacy gets inculcated, not, you know, among students, but among the general people as well. All of us sitting here, we should know how to decipher news.
I think we should definitely say one thing, that it's not that there have not been any media literacy movements, plans. The only thing is that, of course, there's been a problem with the sincerity of intentions. They have been done in a more compliance-oriented kind of a format rather than looking at them more organically. And the second problem is that we always look at things to bring results. So we want a behavior change as the first result and don't think about critical thinking. So I think that's a huge challenge.
I have to say two things. One is that I really welcome this suggestion, and from my institute, I would probably would be happy to collaborate with this, so this could be one outcome. And the other thing is,
we have gotten more sponsors. Sir wants to partner with us in the next summit.
The second point I wanted to make, that as the media, why it couldn't taken off, we teach it under several garbs of several other subjects. Why it couldn't? Because it does not make people employable. You know, they understand the whole nexus of politician, whatever, you know, the industrialist and everyone, and how marketing are, used for selling votes and opinion and everything. We need to be, when we sit together, we need to inject something with media literacy, where we can make it a very marketable thing, where it is whole bigger aspect is
media. Although it's, I'm short of time, but it's getting very cold as well. We all love to go back. The one last point before I hand over to Karthik. Karthik, you know, amidst media literacy, the only point which stands out is how do we create fearless people? How do we create fearless students who can debate, discuss,
come on stage and felicitate.
Why do you stand in front of